Introduction to Two-Dimensional Finite Difference Method. This lecture is intended to just introduce some preliminary concepts that are important for 2D, and even some things we'll cover is important for 1D and 3D simulations. Most of this should be review if you're following the lectures up to this point, but let's go through everything. First of all, a matrix is representing a set of linear equations, linear algebraic equations. And typically we have a big square matrix that has a bunch of coefficients that we know numbers to. That is pre-multiplying a column vector of unknowns that we're trying to find. And there's a series of constants on the right-hand side that is normally described as the excitation. Now, when we interpret the rows of a matrix, we're going to think of the, in this case, the first row as the equation for x, the second row, the equation for y, and the third row, the equation for z. Now, a mathematician that's we would be having a conversation with who's a stickler for details would say, you know what, that first equation has nothing more to do with x than it does y and z. And that is absolutely correct. But it's going to be very useful for us to think this way because each row in the matrix will come from a finite difference equation that we write for one specific point in the grid. So we're going to think of that as the equation for that point in the grid, even though it contains other points in the grid because the finite difference reaches out to adjacent cells to get its information. So that's how we'll think of the rows, the equation for different things. The columns will be the relation to. So for example, if we're in the third equation, we would say that's the equation for z. And if we're looking at the A32 parameter, that's the relation to y. That's describing how z is related to y. Based on that, it makes a little bit of sense why our matrices have some symmetry to them. A32 is describing how y is related to z. A23 is describing how z is related to y. So, you know, it makes sense that these might be the same number or the transpose or something like that. But looking at the rows as the equation for and the columns as the relation to is going to be a very useful way to look at this, and a lot of things will become a lot more intuitive if we have this picture and interpretation of our matrices. Representing functions on a grid. What we're going to say applies for 1D and 3D as well, but we're looking at a 2D function here, and this contains an infinite amount of information. We can't store an infinite amount of information on a computer, so we have to do something to make this storable. We are going to choose to make it discrete by dividing space up into a series of cells. So we do that. Now, if we look within these cells, we notice that that function is still varying. So even though we've divided space up into a series of cells, there's still an infinite amount of information in each one of those cells. So we still can't store that function. So what we do is we only store the value of that function at one infinitely small point inside of each cell. So perhaps a better picture of what is actually stored would look like this. And so we just have discrete values of the functions only at discrete points. We have no idea what's going on between any of those points. Now, I guess I shouldn't say we have no idea. We can do things like interpolations and make pretty good guesses. But the truth is, we just don't know what the function is between those points. And really, we would like to formulate our simulation and our calculations so that we don't ever have to know what is between those points. Now, we'll tend to plot it more like this second case here. But make no mistake, this last case, this fourth case, is really probably the best picture of how things are actually stored in memory. If we zoom in on one of the unit cells here, we'll see that the cell has some height. And so if this is the y direction, we'll give it the resolution parameter delta y. And it has a width. And if this is the x direction, we'll call that delta x. Now, delta x and delta y, we like them to be as equal as possible. We like these to be squares, but it's not necessary and it's not something we need to be real paranoid about. But even still, remember, we are only actually storing our function values at an infinitely small point. And of course, if I drew an infinitely small point, we wouldn't see it. So I made it a little bit big and fat there, but we only store function values at an infinitely small point within a cell. And by that, we're not making an approximation that the function value is constant throughout the cell. Sometimes we image it that way because that's how our graphics works. But more realistically, we'll be assuming that it varies linearly through the cell, but we're just storing one value at one point within the cell. We're in two dimensions now, but regardless, we're still storing our functions in one-dimensional column vectors. Now, this made a lot of sense when we're in one dimension. We just have a single array of numbers, and storing those in a column vector, well, that made sense. But now we're in two dimensions. And so we have a two-dimensional array, yet even still, we're going to store this serially in a one-dimensional column vector. And if you think about it, this is how things are stored in memory anyway. The memory chips don't have two-dimensional memory. It's linear memory. And so basically, we have to figure some pattern of how we raster through this. So we'll choose to store E1, then 2, then 3, then 4. Then we come back to the next line, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. And that's how we list these serially. And in fact, even in three dimensions, we can raster through. Usually we raster along X first, then Y, then Z, and we list everything in a single file line. Here's a way to visualize this. So we start off with our two-dimensional array of numbers. Now imagine we connect these with little bars, and then we run a string through all of these. Then imagine we pull tight that string. We have a column vector. And in MATLAB, we can do this with this one real simple command. If this capital E is our two-dimensional array, if inside parentheses we have a single semicolon, that is telling MATLAB to reshape this to a column vector, and I'm calling that little e. So that's just to match the little e over here. So we'll build stuff on arrays, we'll draw pictures, and when it comes time to do linear algebra, we tend to reshape these to column vectors. Maybe we insert that as a diagonal into a matrix, we do other things, we solve our problem, and we get our answer in terms of a column vector. Well, before we plot it, we need to go back to a two-dimensional array, and MATLAB makes that very easy for us. And we use the reshape command. So we're reshaping this column vector, little e, to an array that's nx by ny points, and we get our big e back. So these two commands, you can imagine going back and forth, back and forth. It's also possible that we could use the reshape command to reshape to a column vector, and we would simply say little e equals reshape big E, and then the first element there would be nx times ny, and then comma 1. But I think this just reads much more cleanly. So I always do this to reshape the column vectors, but just wanted to mention it is possible to use the reshape going both ways. Now let's think about what's going to happen with our finite difference approximations. Sometimes, even in two dimensions, we have what's called a collocated grid. This means all functions are located at the same points in the grid. And so I'm showing a grid something like that here. This happens if we have a single function across two dimensions. That has to be collocated because there are no other functions. However, this can also happen if we have multiple functions. In which case, we write our finite differences something like this, and we want all central finite differences. So therefore, for a first order derivative, we have to actually reach to the adjacent cell, so we're spanning two delta x. We would like to only span one delta x, but for a collocated grid, we really have no choice but to do this. Because if we calculated a finite difference for adjacent points, we'd be calculating the derivative here, and that's not where these function values lie. So if we're taking a derivative in the x direction, let's say we're calculating the first order derivative at this point, then it would be f3(1) minus f1(1) divided by the spacing between them. And then our second order derivative, It would be something like, let's say we're calculating the second order derivative right at f2,1. It would be f3,1 minus 2 times f2,1 plus f1,1 divided by delta x squared. So that's derivatives going horizontally, and almost the same thing for derivatives in the y direction. So let's say we want the second order derivative, first order derivative in the y direction at f3,3. Well, that would be f3,4 minus f3,2 divided by the spacing between them, 2 delta y. And so that's what we're writing here, 2 delta y. And then the second order derivative at f3,3 would be f3,4 minus 2 times f3,3 plus f3,2 divided by delta x squared. So really the only difference between these x and y derivatives is, you know, one's going horizontally in the grid, the other's going vertically in the grid. Now we will also have staggered functions in two dimensions. Let's try to visualize what's going on here. So let's say we have a function f distributed on a grid, but we have some other function and we're evaluating the derivative of f, and we have a second function. We're free now to place that second function at the midpoint between the f's. And this does something wonderful for us. Now our finite difference can be tight only over a single delta x. So the first order derivative at this intermediate point would be f2,1 minus f1,1 divided by delta x, the spacing between them. And that's a much healthier derivative. Now we can use this as long as we're applying this derivative to this intermediate function. If this needs to go along with f, we'd have to go, that's a collocated grid, we'd go back to the previous slide. And so in the y direction, now we're taking derivatives this way, and with central finite differences, our derivatives would exist at the midpoint. So this is already suggesting some kind of staggered grid. Now our other function g would have the midpoints to the left. The f's had our midpoints to the right of the f's, the g's would have them to the left. And so, for example, if we want the derivative at this point, we're going to have a g2,2 minus a g1,2 divided by delta x. And a derivative in this direction, we would have a g2,2 minus g2,1 divided by delta y. So we're staggering, and we'll place the g's at the midpoints between the f's and the f's at the midpoint between the g's in two dimension, and our finite differences work out much more cleanly. I have lots more examples of this in future slides. From the bottom of my heart, thank you very much for watching this video. I love hearing your stories about how these videos helped you. I also love answering your questions. So please tell me your stories and ask your questions in the comment section. I promise I will try to answer every single question that's asked. If you like this video, hit the like and subscribe button. I also recommend visiting the official course website that has links to the latest versions of the notes, the latest videos, and there's lots of other resources to help you learn, including implementations in MATLAB. I'll see you in the next video.